Hello, my name is Clint Locklear, age 43. I live in Dunlap, Tennessee.
And I am an organic, free-range, wild fur farmer. You just cannot get the quality and durability that you can from wild natural fur from synthetics.
I'm a full-time trapper that's based out of Tennessee here. We go all over the country. We've trapped in 21 different states. I'm a mix between a fur trapper when the prices are good and the markets are right to a completely commercial trapper where I go out where people hire me to take care of their coyotes, their bobcats, their hogs, javelina, mountain lions, beaver, otter, different things like that. If they've got coyotes that are killing their deer, we're the ones that they call. Besides being a full-time physical trapper, I've been in the trapping industry again, making my livelihood for 11 years that way. I don't have any other part-time jobs. I don't have any other income coming in as far as me goes. If I can't produce it, I don't make it, and therefore I'm in trouble. Besides having the actual fur money that we catch, we have contracts we do with ranches, different landowners, counties, cities, and sometimes the federal government. For 4 years, we produced our own trapping magazine, Longliner Times. Since then, we've converted that over to digital with wolfernation.com, where it's more video-based. We try to teach and bring trappers together so they can catch more fur and try to expand how important trapping is to our country. Also personally give a lot of personal instruction where trappers pay me to teach them different methods where they can learn from my mistakes and my mileage and my experience being on long lines and control lines. Besides that, we've held general trapping schools. Now we're just doing a Texas predator school where guys that are wanting to be the best that they can be at predator trapping, trying to break into the business of predator control, we take them down on some of our jobs down in Texas. We train them, we teach them, we coach them. We let them do some of the work, and we try to get them every bit of the information and knowledge they need to go out and be able to do what we do on their own. Another aspect of my business is I make instructional videos to teach other trappers the different things that I've learned over the years, whether it be trapping, lure making, different ways that you use traps in different places, animal locations, different things like that. Ourselves make commercial lure for other trappers, where we actually take glands and essential oils and bases and fixatives, and we build stuff together that will allow other trappers to go out and have a very good success on their own trap line. It's the same stuff we use. We do a lot more of that in the summer, to be honest with you, where I'm stuck in a little old building over here pouring gallons and gallons and mixing just 55 gallon drums of material up to be able to put it in bottles, to be able to get it out through our mail order business for our customers. Like I said, I've been making a living now for 11 years totally off trapping in the trapping industry. I've been trapping for over 20 years. I got started with trapping when I was in the military after being in the 101st and the 6th Infantry Division up in Alaska. I started marten trapping in Fairbanks, Alaska. The first trap that I ever set had a male marten, and I've been hooked at it ever since. Besides, when you're in the military and your gross income is $1,400 a month before they take out taxes with a high cost of living in Alaska, and a fur buyer is going to give me $50 for a marten, and it allowed me to be out in the woods and it allowed me to learn about animals that I knew nothing about, it was a perfect mix. And I've trapped all kind of animals through my career. When I was in Alaska, I started with marten, red fox. I tried to do the beaver. I got my tail kicked pretty good with that. I came back to Lower 48 and I started coyote trapping for fun, for fur, muskrat, mink, raccoon, different things like that, and beaver. I got a job for Marion County, Tennessee, where they hired me to go full-time as beaver control. First year I was there, I did 1,104 beaver. After that, it was bouncing between 500 and 700 beaver a year. I did that for 4.5 years. Now, in the middle of all that, I would make sure I had 2 months off from being full-time at Marion County where I could go to different states, which allowed me to start state hopping. Like I said, I've been in 21 different states around this great country of ours, and I've got to experience wildlife and scenes and learning about things most people have no concept about. Since that time of coming back to the Lower 48, where I ran the gamut, ran long lines all across the country, was doing my work for Marion County for the beaver control project they had going on, I've done studies for the University of Georgia. I've helped save snails here in Tennessee. A lot of our work now is based around predators, therefore predator control group. where when people are having fawn recruitment problems, they're having big inseminated bucks that are getting eaten, coyotes and cats and mountain lions are getting their breeding pens, and they're losing money, they call us because we're very good at what we do when we put the hours and we have the knowledge to back it up when we go somewhere. So besides the other water animals, we're also very heavily involved now in coyotes, bobcats, mountain lions. We do some specialty hog work. We can take care of javelina if places need us to. There's not too many things that can walk, crawl, or fly that we can't catch if we set our mind to it. Now, I've had years where I've spent almost 10, 11 months actually physically trapping, doing control work and fur work, going all around the country for different clients and for just the fur, to be honest with you. This year, our season's kind of going where we have 5 or 6 2-week jobs we do throughout the fall, and then we go into our big campaign, which is down in South Texas, where we hit many different ranches. We cover hundreds and hundreds of miles, and we take hundreds and hundreds of animals for landowners. And the way the fur market's going, where it's going up right now, the economy's going down, I'm going to be doing even more trapping than I used to, because we can make a lot better than normal wages now than we could 5, 6, 7 years ago. With the prices of stuff, we can really make some money. And I think even the people that would be interested in a show like this, having a way to make money would definitely get you some interest. Like I said, this is a full-time business for me. I've got a model that I make that's got many different roots off different trees. But since your questionnaire asked what kind of money that I make, this is a little sensitive here. We just came out of Texas. After 30 days, we generated $16,000 in income. I've had days of $1,500, $1,600 on bobcats alone. I've also had days of that in otter, as a matter of fact. $300, $400, $500 a day does not get me excited anymore. When you start getting over that $1,000 a day, now you're really making money. So there's money to be made here. We work at it, we've learned, we've got the experience, and that's how we're able to make the income. And then we have all other aspects of our business that are helping support that, that gives us the time and the resources to go out and be able to make that kind of money. Well, the prices right now are something that we haven't seen in the last, really, except for one or two peaks since 1987, before Black Friday, when the stock market crashed. We're getting to see prices now that really allow a guy to go out and make some really good money, being part of wildlife, being in the circle of life, and be able to have something in production where it's going to make someone's life better with using wild fur. Right now, the bobcat prices are anywhere from $70 to $1,000. Otter are bouncing right around a $100 bill. We call them Benjamins because of that fact, $100 bill apiece. Raccoons are a little low this year. Coyotes are hitting around that $40 mark, which allows you to catch 3 a day. That's $120 a day. Here in Dunlap, Tennessee, no one at a factory makes $120 a day, probably. So in my type of area, that's really, really good money. Even the lonely little muskrats bringing $10 a piece. You go catch 1,000 of them, that's 10 grand. Beavers up now, they're about $45, talking about the prices a little bit. Go catch 500 or 1,000 of them. Catch 1,000 at $40, that's $40,000. I can make a living on $40,000 on just fur. And trapping has its inherent dangers. It really depends about where you're at, how hard you're trapping, and how much you're willing to push your body to get the numbers you need to try to make a living at this. I've had times where it's been so cold after falling in the Squatchy River here, when it's about 27 degrees, that I thought I was gonna be a goner to hypothermia, body almost completely shut down. I've had times muskrat trapping and beaver trapping that my hands are so cold, I physically could not move them anymore and had to stop and put them under my armpits. And a lot of pain involved in that. That's just some of the dangers. Wind exposure, cold, all this stuff really racks up on your body. The complete opposite of that spectrum is when I go down to Texas and it's 97 or 125 degrees and it's 80% humidity and you're drinking water as fast as you can, there's not a cloud in the sky. I've had times where no shade, the air quit working on one of my trucks, where you start graying out behind the wheel. I've been trapping in Iowa where you start at 3:30 in the morning and you go till that night and you do it day after day after day, where no matter how much coffee, tea, Mountain Dew you want to drink, you're gonna have trouble staying awake as you're skinning with sharp knives and driving on the road. So when you push yourself, the dangers become a lot more. because of where we go in Texas, we do have a little bit of more danger than a lot of guys do. We're right on the border of Texas. We've got to always be armed. We go in pairs for security. We're dealing with Border Patrol all the time. We're seeing illegals all the time. There's a lot of drug traffic that's going on through the area we're at, so that's an inherent danger. I've only had to have a pistol on one person once, thank goodness, didn't have to pull the trigger. Some of the other weird stuff you get caught up in is every now and then you may accidentally catch an alligator, and if it's an 8-foot alligator, how are you going to get him out of your trap? Let me tell you, that's a hair-raising experience for someone that hadn't grown up around alligators. We got it done, though. I've had to fight water moccasins. I've had rattlesnakes strike at me. I had rattlesnakes strike at my four-wheeler. I've had hogs almost run me over when you're trapping them. There's just a lot of things that can go wrong. One thing about this job, it's never boring. I personally think that I've got the best job in the world. It's exactly what I want to be doing. Most of the time, it's where I want to be. The only downside of my job is being away from my wife, Cindy, as much as I have to be sometimes. But I'm like a kid in a candy store every day. I get to go out and be part of nature. I get to learn something that I didn't know yesterday. I get to try techniques that I've only thought of, and now I get to see if they work. Dealing with animals on a day-to-day basis is the most fulfilling thing a person can do, because now you're in contact with nature. You're dealing with nature. You're not trying to just overcome and take nature. You're actually being part of it. It's not something I'm just seeing on a TV screen. It's something I've actually got in my hands when I'm out on the line. I've got to know their habits. I got to know where they're eating. I got to know when their food source changes. I got to know what they're doing in breeding season. I got to know what happens if you get a drought or you get a flood, or if you had disease go through that territory, or what's happened on different parts of the country where I may be wanting to go. I'm always getting to be in contact with other trappers through our websites and the radio show, and I've got friends I call, and I get fur reports. And it's just always building towards this information. And the biggest thing to me that I love about trapping more than anything else is I don't think there's any way a person can learn everything there is to know about trapping. Which may seem hard to someone that thinks you just put something that smells bad in a trap in front of it that you catch animals. That is not the way it works in the wild. That may be the way it works in Hollywood, but not out here in the wild. You've got to know everything about that animal. Sometimes, because of our work, we're having to chase down an individual coyote. And I've had coyotes that I've chased for 2 weeks and I couldn't catch. It is very frustrating. But one of these days, I'm going to figure out how to catch that particular animal, and I'm going to be that much smarter than I was before I had that experience. And to me, that's what it's all about. What's a better trap? What's a better way to make a snare? What's the fastest way to get the most animals in a truck? How can I cover more miles in a single day? How can I get more traps out from a boat? How can I check it? What are the different laws in different states? How can I can use that in my advantage for me personally? Because we're set up as a group and I've got guys I can depend on. We can hit different places at once. Everybody comes out ahead because we're going in such a full force measure that it's so fulfilling, and it's such a learning process, because I may learn about a technique that Scott Adams figures out in Arkansas or a different part of Texas that I hadn't tried yet, and I can try that on my line. That learning and understanding the animals in such an intimate way is just so fulfilling to me as a person, because I'm actually get to be part of the circle of life in nature because I am a trapper. What are the stakes to trapping to me? Well, to be honest, it's everything. I could lose my house, my cars, everything I've got. Every one of these, this is what we consider in trapping currency. This cat right here is worth about $200 this year. This cat right here is worth about $300 right here. I've got to go out and catch so much stuff along with our other ways that we make money in the trapping industry, or I can't make my house payment, I can't make my car payments or insurance or pay my taxes or do any of that. So what's at stake for me? Absolutely everything. Now, there are some things that I don't like about trapping. I really wish there was a way that I could catch a bobcat like this and have a heart-to-heart talk with him and explain to him that if he would just stay out of the pens and not eat the fawns or the turkey, that we could go our separate ways, and after our discussion, I could turn him loose. Or we could just take a picture of the animals we catch and sell the photographs for the same amount of money. That's not gonna happen. That's just not reality. The other part that drives me crazy about trapping is the misconceptions that people have about it. I sleep with three cats and a dog and my wife every night. My wife thinks if she comes back and reincarnated, she wants to be Daisy, my dog. But people think because we take animals' lives and we're, just like I said, an organic free-range wild fur farmer, we're out farming wildlife just like a farmer does that grows sheep or cattle or does anything else in the agricultural industry, that somehow we hate animals like this. I don't hate them. I've got massive respect for them because I actually understand what makes them tick. I don't hate them at all. I take no joy at all out of taking one of them's life. But that's just the world that we live in, the way the rules are set up. If I could take a picture of them, I would be glad to. The only other thing about trapping that I really don't like is to make a living at this. It's really hard to do it in your backyard, which means I've got to spend time away from my family. Daisy now is getting old and she can't go with me anymore, so I don't have her as a companion. So a lot of times it's lonely. I'm somewhere 2 weeks. I may or may not see another person except at a grocery store. So being away from home after all these years is starting to wear on me. But the fulfillment I get out of trapping completely outweighs the negatives. Now, since you asked this question, I'm going to talk about some of the numbers that we catch that, except for some close friends and some of the advertising we do in the trapping industry, I've never really talked about publicly on the internet or anything. I've had a year over 1,100 beaver. I've had several years over 700 beaver. When otter prices were really high about 6 or 7 years ago, I was in that 100 to 150 range on otter, which that's a very elusive animal to be able to catch. I've caught as high as 400 coyotes in a year. I've caught as many as 180 bobcats in a year. We've had several years now being over 100 bobcats. Where we hold our Texas Predator School, first year we were down there, we took 333 animals. Coyotes, bobcats, mountain lions, raccoons, all the way down to porcupines and different things like that. This year we're over 300 there again. A lot of times we're catching 8, 10, 12 bobcats a day, sometimes as high as 20 coyotes in a day. Depending on where we're at, I've had days of high as 40 beaver in a single day, 50 and 60 muskrats in a day, 30 and 40 raccoons in a 24-hour period, 9 otter in a single day. We're pretty good at what we do because we really work at it. I don't have any children. I do have probably one of the best wives a man could ever have. Her name is Cindy. She handles the mail order for me when I'm on the road. She's a big supporter of what I do. She doesn't like that I'm gone so much, but that's just the world that we live in. Because of what I do for a career. Don't have children, but I do have some house cats that I'm very fond of. I've got Daisy, which is probably one of those dogs in a lifetime that most guys hope they get to have, and I've been so grateful that she's been with me now for about 11 years. She's been with me to several states. She's been with me when I've been snaring beaver. She goes in the boat with me. She's been coyote trapping. She's taught me a tremendous amount about animals and how they react to stuff because she's there with me all the time, and she's a lot closer to nature than I am. Now, this wasn't on the questions that I was asked, but I would like to have a little input, I think, about why I believe Predator Control Group, or me, Clint Locklear, would be an asset to a show like what it seems like y'all are doing. For one, we're the leader in what we do in the country as far as Predator Control Group goes. We go to some of the biggest ranches. We have some of the most high profile clients that may or may not want you to have them on film. I don't know. But we have a loose group. Predator Control Group has a loose group. We have other professional trappers that will come down, and we all work together as a team. And we do it just like we did in the military, where we have a mission. We have a mission statement. We have, I guess you could say, I'm the general of this. Sometimes I get called that, just kidding around. But we're very mission orientated. We're very professional at what we do. We use the best equipment. We're always testing new equipment to find out which has the less damage to an animal with a higher catch ratio, how can we get more animals faster, different things like that. We have a lot of skill sets that we're always learning from inside the group. We're always teaching each other when we're going to different places. And some people are better at foothold trapping, some better at snaring, some better at conibearing. We all work together as a team, and when we go somewhere, it's full balls to the walls when we get there. We're usually setting traps before we go to bed that night after a 1,000-mile drive down to Texas. We're dealing with the Border Patrol and the illegals and the hogs and alligators and all that type stuff that a person on a normal trap line just being in their backyard or in their back door is not going to have the access or the experience to be able to show or do.
Now I grew up down an old dirt road in a town you wouldn't know. My pops picked the place up for $1,500 back in 1964. My grandfather was a drinker back in the day, put him down. But a war is known to change a man, and the whiskey's known to change a man. That's not me. I rarely drink from the bottle, but I'll smoke a little weed. I still live in the sticks where you wouldn't go, in a town of 1,200 off an old dirt road, and a country boy is all I'll ever be. Now it's been 12 years since I sold my soul to the devil in L.A. He said, sign your name here on the dotted line, and your songs they all will play. He set up shop on Sunset, he put me up at the Marquee. He said,
you wanna sell a million records, boy, you better listen to me.
He said,
change your style, whiten your smile, you could lose a couple of pounds. If you wanna live this life, you better lose that wife. Do you need your friend around?
I said, no, that's not me. Cause the biggest things in life are your friends and family. I like my jeans and my old t-shirts, and a couple extra pounds never really hurt. Cause a country boy is all I'll ever be. Cause Hank taught me just how to stay alive. You never catch me out the house without my 9 or 45. One is the colors that fly high and proud, the red, the white, the blue. The other one's got a rattlesnake with a simple statement made. Don't tread on me is what it says, and I'll take that to my grave. Because this is me. I'm proud to be American and strong in my belief. And I've said it before, but I'll say it again, cause I've never needed government to hold my hand. And I've said it before, but I'll say it again, cause my family's always fought and died to save this land. And a country boy is all I'll ever be. We'll be right back.
love my country. I love my guns. I love my family. I love the way it is now. And anybody that tries to change it has to come through me. That should be all of our attitudes. Is this is America, and a country boy's good enough for me, son.
That morning sun made its way through the windshield of my Chevrolet. Whiskey eyes and ashtray breath on a church rock gravel road. What the hell did I do last night? That's the story of my life. Like trying to remember words to a song nobody wrote. And it's sad and it's long, and can't nobody sing along. It's a southbound train, it's a whistle and the wind. Ain't no one there to care where I've been. I'm humming on that lonesome song again.